that stuff I was taught about evolution and embryology and Big Bang Theory, all that is lies straight from the pit of hell. And it's lies to try to keep me and all the folks who are taught that from understanding that they need a Savior. You see, there are a lot of scientific data that I found out as a scientist that actually show that this is really a young Earth. I don't believe that the Earth is but about 9,000 years old. I believe it was created in 6 days as we know them. That's what the Bible says. And what I've come to learn is that it's the manufacturer's handbook, is what I call it. It teaches us how to run our lives individually, how to run our families, how to run our churches. But it teaches us how to run all of public policy and everything in society. And that's the reason, as your congressman, I hold the Holy Bible as being the major directions to me of how I vote in Washington, D.C., and I'll continue to do that.
How do we know evolution happens?
Fossils provide the most interesting evidence for evolution, and certainly the most powerful for most people.
I want you to look behind us.
There's an abundance of hard evidence at the molecular, chemical, and anatomical level that evolution happens. But perhaps it's the clues hardened in stone that tell evolution's story most vividly.
Here are the backbones. You can see how big these vertebrae are.
The history of life is all a record in fossils, millions of them, from strata, layer by layer by layer back through time, are all interconnected. Now, partly this layering and succession is how we tell time in geology, but it's also the principal evidence that life has changed through time, that life has evolved through time, that the things living today can all be connected back through time to common ancestors.
These now lifeless dry rocks are gold to paleontologists. They are the puzzle pieces to the origin of one of the most powerful and majestic animals on Earth, the whale.
The evolution of whales has always been sort of a mystery. They're like us in that they're very intelligent. They're mammals. They're warm-blooded. They nurse young and feed them milk. But they're very, very different. I mean, they live in water. They can hear in water. And they swim around like fish. So the question is this. We know that mammals originally evolved on land, yet whales live in the water. How did that shift, how did that evolution happen from life on land to life in the water?
That question consumes paleontologist Phil Gingrich. The evolution of whales has been his passion ever since 1978, when his team unearthed a rock in Pakistan that appeared to have a skull embedded in it.
When we found it, all you could see was the brain case. Well, I thought it was a wolf-like animal with a very small brain. When it was cleaned, the ears were uncovered, and I could see that it had a very characteristic whale ear, and that shows us that what we have is a whale, not a wolf, not a deer, not some other kind of mammal, but a fossil whale.
Gingrich named the whale ancestor Pakicetus. With only its skull as evidence, scientists do not know for sure what the rest of Pakicetus looked like. But some scientists hypothesize that it resembled a modern seal.
Okay, look at this, Bill. Here's this.
Paleontologists look for fossils that have transitional features from one way of life to another. And then here's the advanced. They use these related forms to create a comprehensive picture of evolutionary change. When fossils of related species are located, scientists organize them by their physical similarities. Sometimes these similarities don't evolve all at once, like the whale ear of Pachycetus, which lacks many other whale-like features in its backbone and limbs.
Whales' bodies contain inside them connections or clues to their past. I mean, their mammalian traits are signs of their recent history, but they're also signs of a very ancient history. Take their flippers. On the outside, their flippers look like fish fins, but on the inside, the bones of that flipper are very similar to those in a monkey's arm, in the wing of a bird, and in the limb of a frog.
Egypt today seems an unlikely place for Phil Gingrich to find intermediate whale fossils.
This is Whales Valley in Egypt. You can see behind me there are many hills of sandstone standing above shale. What's important, it's called Valley of Whales because there are about 400 skeletons of whales weathering out here. This was a wide open blue sea with a full range of sea life living in it. A lot of invertebrate shellfish, sharks, about 5 or 6 kinds of whales living here.
Gingrich searches for intermediates with hind limbs and feet to trace back until those feet and hind limbs are as big and fully functional as any four-footed animal that lives on land.
It is a Basilosaurus. Look at this. Here's the skull, incisors up front, the rest of the teeth come back to here, and then the whole length of the skull is over a meter.
His find, Basilosaurus, had tiny hind legs with a mobile knee and several toes, and lived 35 to 41 million years ago. Here's where scientists place this transitional form on the fossil record. The discovery of another fossil has led scientists to conclude that whales evolved from a land mammal much like this one, called Synonyx. Perhaps its descendants found the water a source of abundant food and a haven from competition. Over millions of years, through variation and selection, front legs became fins, rear legs disappeared, bodies lost fur and took on their familiar streamlined shape.
Whales show us the sheer creative power of evolution. I mean, from a wolf-like creature to a whale in 10 or so million years is amazing.
Each dig and discovery adds more stone, more bone, more hard evidence for evolution, for the origin of life, for its history here on Earth, and for the evolutionary relationships among all forms of life. How does evolution really work?
The primary way that evolution occurs is through the action of natural selection. That is, populations change in response to environmental pressures, and they become adapted to new conditions, and they change over time.
Following Charles Darwin's lead, biologist Chris Schneider and his colleagues travel to Ecuador to study the evolution of several animal species. This lush rainforest is a natural laboratory for ongoing investigation of evolutionary theory. Natural selection is at the core of their research on hummingbirds.
In our research, we're trying to understand how new species arise. This is Darwin's fundamental question, on the origin of species. How do new species arise? And what we're finding is that natural selection seems to be an incredibly important factor in generating new species.
Natural selection, the key evolutionary mechanism Darwin identified, is really four processes. Genetic variation, overproduction of offspring, struggle for existence, and differential survival and reproduction. First, genetic variation. Individuals within a species vary from one to the other. For evolution to work by natural selection, the characteristics that give an individual an advantage in a certain environment have to be passed on from one generation to the next.
And in hummingbirds, bill length seems to have a very strong genetic basis. That is, if two parents mate and both of those parents have long bills, their offspring will have long bills. If those parents have shorter bills, their offspring will have shorter bills.
Second, there is overproduction of offspring.
Darwin realized that natural selection would operate because individuals in natural populations tend to produce more offspring than can survive. For example, hummingbirds over their lifetime will often produce dozens of offspring, but only one or two of those individuals are likely to survive.
The third factor in natural selection is the struggle for existence, and that leads to differential survival and reproduction.
In any population, whether it's plants or animals or whatever, this excess production of individuals results in this, in what Darwin called the struggle for existence. And what he had in mind there, I think, was the competition for food and space and mates as well. Hummingbirds compete for nectar. They often compete very fiercely for limited resources. Natural selection will favor individuals that are more efficient at getting nectar, and natural selection will result in changes in wing shape that allow hummingbirds to fly longer distances, for instance, or maybe to be more maneuverable, to maneuver around flowers and get nectar more efficiently. And probably most importantly, it'll affect the length and shape of the bill.
Bill measurements.
In the case of hummingbirds, we know that a 1 or 2 millimeter change in length can have profound differences on how efficiently that bird feeds and how well it survives.
Individual survivors are more likely to reproduce and pass on their advantageous as well as other genes to their offspring. In an environment with long flowers, having a long bill is an advantageous trait. Not necessarily the absolute best trait always, just a better one in this environment. Hummingbirds with small bills may not survive, and eventually there will only be hummingbirds with long bills. Over a long period of time, the entire population of hummingbirds adapts to the shape and size of the flowers that exist in that environment.
If you're in the woods and you're walking with another person and you come on a bear and the bear chases you, you don't have to be faster than the bear. You only have to be faster than the other person because the bear eats them and you get away.
Species cannot develop the adaptations that benefit them in their lifetimes. Just as you cannot make your arm longer to reach a book on the shelf up high, individual small-billed hummingbirds that move into an area where there are longer flowers can't make their bills longer. Their bill length is determined by the DNA they inherited from their parents.
Okay.
Schneider uses hummingbird DNA sequences to reconstruct their evolutionary history as it has been shaped by natural selection. Genetic variation, overproduction of offspring, struggle for existence, and differential survival and reproduction.
We're just essentially doing what Darwin did, but with a bunch of fancy new tools. We're using molecular biology, we're using modern computational methods and all these things, but we're just doing basic natural history, really.
Metallura.
And in the hummingbirds, we found that many of the species are relatively young. That is, they've evolved in the last 2 or 3 million years, which is pretty quick on an evolutionary timescale. Darwin emphasized over and over, I mean repeatedly, in The Origin of Species, the fact that small changes would accrue every generation, and that over the enormous length of time that life has been present on Earth, these changes could build up to amount to enormous changes.
It was Charles Darwin's genius to have identified natural selection as the central force in evolution.
And I think that in research over the last 10 or 15 years has really supported that. I think most evolutionary biologists would agree that natural selection is probably the single most important force in evolution.